He does love them, you know. It's just that, well, some men don't know how to show it. Oh, and I know I don't help much nagging him all the time, but I just can't stop myself. Sometimes it just gets me down.
You're not the only one who'd feel like that.
Look, have you ever thought about joining a play group?
They're run by mothers, just like yourself.
They're good fun, and the children have others to play with. Now, I've made a few inquiries.
Hello, darling. Oh, you gave Mummy such a scare.
We gave Jason a thorough examination, Mrs. Summers. You didn't mention that he'd broken his arm recently.
Oh, well, he's always tripping over his feet. But Dr. Whitlow said it was mending okay.
He's the family doctor.
I've been to him a few times.
We also found some bruising.
Oh, that's nothing. He's always getting into scraps with his sister, aren't you?
Well, you just try and keep a good eye out for him in future, huh?
Thanks, Doctor.
Gail, could you just wait downstairs for a minute? I just want to ring work and tell them where I am.
Excuse me, Doctor.
I'm Mrs. Summers, next door neighbour. Now, I know you can't discuss your patients, but I just don't believe that Jason is accident prone.
Do you have any reason to believe otherwise?
Well, I've only just moved in, but... All right. Now, I know it's a serious accusation, but I believe that Jason's been abused by his stepfather.
Stepfather? What about the other two kiddies?
They seem fine.
Ah, it's usually the way. One child bears the brunt.
Well, is there anything that you can do? Or me?
Well, I had intended going to the family doctor. We could build up a case. But the trouble with child abuse, if that's what we're dealing with here, is it's very hard to prove anything in the initial stages.
Initial stages?
Unless the child has a history of unexplained accidents, or a witness can testify that he's seen the child actually abused, very difficult to do anything at all. Some of the time, we're too late.
You and Beck at Bourke must think we was born yesterday.
I don't know what you're talking about.
She gave herself away when she put a fiver on a nag that'll come home a day late. Now even Bourke isn't that stupid. Bee's gonna be real pleased to hear about this, I'd reckon. Yeah, real pleased.
Trying to scare me to death. Oh, look what you made me do.
Sorry. Look, you're a bit on edge, aren't you?
I just didn't hear you, that's all. Well, come on, what'd you find out? You took long enough.
Not very much.
What do you mean, not very much? You followed her like I said, didn't you?
It was my idea, remember? She's on to us.
So what happened?
Oh, well, I was right behind her when she left the dining room. She heads off for the loo, so I have to hang around there till she comes out. Then halfway along the corridor, she doubles back towards the kitchen. Then Bev and Lil appear out of nowhere.
Oh, her and her bloody goons. So then what?
So then nothing. You don't think I'm going to hang about with those two heavies for company, do you?
No, I don't suppose so. Could have been a coincidence.
Not a chance. It was all too convenient. Anyway, she said she'd been on to us and had been from the very beginning. And she's going to tell B.
Oh, dirty, rotten bitch. Well, she's not going to get away with it. You think it's hid in the kitchen?
Well, that's where she was heading, and she does spend a lot of time there.
Think I might spend a bit of time in there myself.
I reckon you ought to wait for a while, you know, try and get on kitchen duty.
Oh, what, and give her time to stash it somewhere else? No way.
She'll be watching pretty closely.
I'm not scared of her. Besides, I put $5 on a nag that's probably pigeon-toed. Just gonna get me money back. And hers.
Hey, anybody home?
Oh, I'm sorry, Paul. I was a million miles away.
What's the problem?
Actually, it's something I wanted to talk to you about. You might be able to help.
Sure, come into the office. Okay, what's the worry?
Well, it's my neighbours, you know. You met them the other night?
Oh, yes, Gail, wasn't it? She struck me as rather a nice person. Mind you, I didn't take too kindly to her husband. I don't like people who barge in on a group of strangers dragging their domestic problems with them.
Oh, it's not the family squabbles I'm worried about. It's their eldest boy, Jason, I'm concerned for. You know, I think he's been mistreated.
And what makes you say that?
Well, it's lots of things. Well, last night, for instance, I heard them having one hell of a blue. There was a lot of screaming and the kids were yelling and then her husband slammed out of the flat. Well, just after he left, Gail came to ask for help. She said that Jason had fallen out of his bed and hit his head. Well, he had to take him to the hospital.
Was he badly hurt?
No, not even a concussion, actually. The doctor said he'd be fine and just kept him overnight for observation.
Well, couldn't it have happened exactly the way she said it did? I mean, lots of families fight from time to time. The two things needn't be connected.
They don't fight from time to time. They fight constantly.
All right, Meg. Unfortunately, a lot of families fight constantly.
Well, look, normally, Paul, I would agree with you, but there are other things. Well, for instance, the doctor who examined him found a recently healed break in his arm, and he's got an awful lot of bruises, both old and new.
Well, I admit that doesn't sound too good, but he could be an awkward kid who just keeps walking into things and falling over a lot.
That's what Gail said. She called it accident prone.
Yeah, well, there are such kids, you know.
Oh, Paul, it just doesn't ring true. And from what I've overheard, her husband's got a pretty violent temper. Now, I was wondering if there's anyone in the child welfare department you knew who could look into it.
Yes, I know one or two people, but it's a pretty dicey situation. And all you've got to go on is your own suspicion. Look, why don't you have a talk to Gail? She seems to get along well with you. She might confide in you.
No, I've tried that and I didn't get anywhere. She was immediately on the defensive and refused to say a word against him.
Which is exactly how she would react if, in fact, he were completely innocent.
Or if she were afraid of him.
Jason, will you stop making all that noise? Mummy's got a headache, love.
Listen, you help Mummy then. We'll play a game. Let's see who can get all the toys back in the basket the fastest. Come on, Jace, you love playing games. Mummy doesn't want to play alone. I'll tell you what, we'll have a race. Let's see who can get them all in the fastest. Come on.
Mummy's going to find out why Stevie's crying, love. Now, don't you get into any trouble while I'm gone. When I come back...
No one's doing it.
When I come back, we'll play another game.
That mop works a lot better with someone on the end of it, Bourke. Get moving.
I was just waiting to powder my nose. Unless you want me to work with my legs crossed.
All right, but don't take all day about it.
Well, what's the time limit on nose powdering these days?
It's enough cheek out of you, Bourke, unless you want to do these floors all over again just to make sure they're really clean.
You love it. I'm taking a break. You two keep an eye on the doors.
Thanks, nice to see you all so well supplied. Any bets for this afternoon's races?
Uh-uh.
How about you, Lizzie? Gonna take another fly?
I ain't got no money.
Besides, gambling's a sin.
Yeah, you big losers break my heart.
Look out!
Get those bags out.
Later, I'll
later what, Gaffney?
It's later than I thought, Miss Bennett. I wouldn't want to keep anyone from their work.
You three don't seem to have enough to occupy yourselves. I'll see what I can do about that. Is there something wrong with your arm, Birdsworth?
Oh, no, Miss Bennett. I just needed a break. It's good for me ticky, you know.
You should be out of cigarettes by now.
Yeah, it's real funny, Miss Bennett. Just when I thought I'd run out and I was dying for a fag, I found a whole packet I'd stashed away for a rainy day. The Lord will provide.
Oh, God. Now get to work, all of you, or there'll be trouble.
The Lord will provide.
Like the Lord helps those who help themselves.
Yeah, I reckon.
More carefully in here, girls. There's garbage hanging out of the deep freeze.
What do you think you're doing?
Nothing, Bourke. It's just that we like to work in a tidy kitchen. It upsets us to have garbage lying around. Smells real bad. Don't it, girls?
Yeah.
Stinks. I reckon rubbish ought to be put where it belongs.
Mr. Fletcher, can I have a word with you, please?
Yes, what is it, Miss Bennett?
I've just come from the laundry. Birdsworth was smoking.
Well, what's so unusual about that?
The women were denied buyer privileges. They should be out of cigarettes by now.
Well, maybe she had an extra packet tucked away somewhere.
That's what she said. But these women are too weak-willed to save anything. Have you noticed anything suspicious among the other girls?
No, I can't say I have.
All right, what's so funny?
We're just enjoying ourselves, Miss Bennett. We love it inside.
That's enough, Gaffney. What's going on?
It's like I said, Miss Bennett, we just love being inside. Of course, not all the women feel the same. Bourke was just saying to me a minute ago that she didn't much care for the accommodation. As a matter of fact, we just saw her outside the kitchen and it looked like she was planning to leave.
Come on, out of the way.
Now get on with your work. Maybe she just didn't like the food, Miss Bennett. She said it tasted like garbage. What on earth are you doing in there, Bourke?
I really don't think it was her idea somehow, Miss Bennett. Oh, on second thought, she does seem rather anxious to get back in there again.
Oh, very funny. Just help me get out of here.
Report to Mrs. Davidson immediately.
Yeah, I think you'd better have a shower first, though, Bourke. You really are a bit on the bugle.
Come on. Right.
Oh.
Yeah.
Like I told you, we was just having a bit of fun.
Yeah, well, you can tell it to the governor straight after lunch. I'm sure she'll be fascinated to find out why you chose to have your bit of fun in the rubbish bin. Yeah.
Ooh. Phew! What have you been doing to yourself, you pog?
Why don't you mind your own business?
Oh, good. You don't have to ask me twice.
Oh, I just want to put you out with the garbage.
Shut up, Smith.
Oh, well, well, well. Sounds like someone finally put the trash where it belongs.
Who did it to you?
Yeah, we'd like to know who to thank. Oh, speaking of trash, ladies, that's lunch.
Come in.
Thank you, Miss Bennett.
Bourke, I understand you were found hiding in the grounds this morning.
No, I wasn't.
I beg your pardon?
I wasn't hiding. I was in the bin.
Yes, so I understand. I would like an explanation.
Some of the women warned us. Mr. Fletcher and I got there just in time. She was trying to escape.
Trying to escape? I was not. Who told you that?
That does not concern you. What I would like to know is why you were... where you were.
We was just mucking around.
Who's we?
Me and some of me mates.
Their names? Bourke, I am waiting for their names.
Well, as I told you, we was just mucking around.
Very well.
If you refuse to tell me any more, then you will be refused by our privileges for the next week. Thank you, Miss Bennett. You can take her back now. I have called this meeting to discuss a proposal put forward by Mr. Reynolds, which in my opinion is of mutual benefit. As some of you already know, Mr. Reynolds runs a clothing factory. He has recently received quite a large contract from the government, and it is his idea that some of our women be allowed to work in the factory making uniforms.
Well, we've successfully had quite a few women out on work release before.
Yes, but this would involve specified women working in the factory all together as a group.
Mrs. Davidson, the women are hard enough to control inside the prison. They could never be trusted outside together.
Yes, I agree with Miss Bennett. How could we maintain security with the women in a group?
May I just interrupt here to say that a similar scheme has been in operation at Parramatta for some time, with a great deal of success. I'm sure any security problem can be overcome.
I'm sure they could, with a great deal of extra work from the staff.
Mr. Reynolds showed me through his factory yesterday, and there is an area where the women could be completely segregated from the rest of the workers. I don't think that security would be as difficult to maintain as you imagine.
There would still have to be an officer on duty outside the prison. Well, it strikes me that all the benefits are to Mr. Reynolds.
How would the women get back and forth from the prison?
I was planning to supply a minibus, at my own expense, of course. That should take care of any transportation problem.
Well, that's very generous. But then I imagine you're saving quite a bit of money, using the women here as cheap labour.
Look, Miss Bennett, is it? Naturally, the women wouldn't be paid as much as the ordinary workers. But money was not my prime consideration. I simply thought the scheme would be beneficial to all concerned.
Well, I think if we iron out the problems, we should at least give it a try.
Yes, but I don't think the benefits are worth all the problems it could create.
Well, I suggest we put it to the vote. All those in favour? Against? Well, I think it's well worth a try. And with my vote, the suggestion is carried.
Oh, Mrs. Davidson, might I suggest that if Mr. Reynolds has time, we take him down and introduce him to some of the women who'll be involved in this project and find out what they have to say about it.
Well, I do have to get back, but if we could do it right away...
Certainly.
They'll think it's a wonderful idea. We're playing right into their hands.
Well, it's been nice meeting you all. I'm sorry you're not all in agreement, but I'm sure it will work out very well.
Well, that's Mr. Reynolds' proposition. I take it you all approve of the idea?
Oh, we sure do, Mrs. Davidson.
I'm sure you realise that this is a privilege and will be withdrawn if you abuse it.
Oh, we wouldn't do that, Mrs. Davidson.
Oh, just make sure that you don't. To encourage you, normal privileges will be restored as of now.
Oh, terrific. Yeah, yeah.
Well, that is all. Carry on with your work.
Ladies.
Bye. Oh, isn't he nice? Gee, Lizzie, I might even get to see Kevin somehow.
Yeah, and with a bit of a fiddle, I might be able to keep an eye on my newfound family.
Yay!
All right, you two. That's enough of your half-baked schemes. We have just been offered a good deal. I'm not going to see either of you mess it up. That goes for the rest of you, too. Clear?
Yes.
God.
Clear?
Yeah.
Okay, back to work. We don't want Mr. Reynolds to think we're not good workers.
And how's Jason?
Oh, he's just fine now. Tim and I are both so grateful for the way you helped. Getting us to the hospital and all.
Well, I hope Tim didn't think I was too interfering.
Heavens, no! Oh, I can see you got the wrong impression of Tim. Though I must admit, the few times you have seen him, he hasn't exactly been at his best. But when you get to know him, you'll find he's really a great bloke. Sometimes, I wouldn't blame him if he left me.
Why?
Oh, well, I'm not exactly the greatest housekeeper in the world. I don't have to tell you, you've seen the place. I don't know. I never even seem to get time to cook properly. When he gets home, the place is in a mess and the kids are screaming and... Oh, I don't blame him for losing his temper sometimes. Oh, I guess you can hear us in here.
Well, the walls in these buildings are rather thin.
Well, everybody fights.
It must be hard for him to keep his patience with the children after a long day at work.
Yeah.
Especially Jason. I noticed he's got a lot of bruises. I suppose with all that energy, he's always throwing himself around and bumping into things. Oh, I must nearly drive you up the wall. I suppose he's got to be smacked now and then.
Listen, I better go. I really shouldn't leave the kids for this long.
Oh, you haven't been very long. Besides, you said they were asleep. Do you want another cup?
Oh, thanks anyway, but I'd better go back and start tidying up the flat. Thanks for the coffee, and I'll see you later.
Will you drop in any time?
I wonder how they're going to choose who's going.
You sound interested. Thinking about all those new clients, huh?
Something like that.
They could have their own bookie, you know. Remember what I said. No funny business. Anyone messes this up, they've got me to answer to. Is that understood?
Hey, I was watching that.
Not near you, not.
No.
She said she was watching it, Bourke.
Yeah.
Now, you're all done anyway. What's so great about working in a factory? They rake in the dough and just rip you off. They're just conning you. Wouldn't catch me working there. Hey, Margo, when are we going to get them race results?
Psst. Belt up, Bourke.
Oh, drop dead.
I'll leave that to your horse.
I don't believe it.
Don't tell me your horse did drop dead.
I just don't believe it. The bloody thing won!
Oh, there's no justice.
That's you.
What's the matter with you?
Hasn't been exactly what you'd call a good day. I'm sick of them bitches rubbishing me.
Well, I never said anything.
You'd be the only one.
Oh, come on, it'll blow over. Besides, you said yourself that you didn't care what they said. I mean, why should it suddenly upset you now?
Well, they just give me a pain, that's all. Who needs them?
What's really bothering you, Noeline?
I'm worried about my family, that's all. I mean, I didn't get my hands on that money. If I don't get some out to them soon, the welfare will take the kids away.
Yeah, I know, it's tough. I'm real sorry I didn't get it for you, but I can try again. I'm sure it's somewhere in the kitchen.
Oh, yeah, and so are Margo and her goons. We got Buckley's now.
Hey, Bourke, come here.
Drop dead.
Well, I guess you'll just have to pick it up then.
Look at that!
Woo!
The horse must be coming. She's a bit that made that bitch real happy.
Yeah. We're going to have to figure some way to get this to your family. I'll help you, Noel. I'll think of something.
Yeah, thanks.
Good morning, Miss Bennett.
Mrs. Davidson.
Where's Sally?
She's late again, and I've got better things to do than to answer the phone. See?
Good morning, Wentworth Detention Centre. Good morning, Mr. Douglas. Have you come to any decision yet about the Reynolds factory project? Oh, that's excellent. No, I haven't come to any decision as yet, but I shall be able to finalise the list by this afternoon. Right, I'll speak to you then. Goodbye, Ted, and thank you.
Well, I take it that factory charade is still going ahead?
Yes. Is Mr. Reed in yet?
5 minutes ago.
Good.
Wentworth.
Mr. Reed, may I have a word with you?
Yes, of course.
I've just heard the department has approved the factory project. I'd like you to make out a list of the 6 women to go.
I'm very pleased to hear that, but I would have thought you'd be making out your own lists.
Well, you know the women. I'm sure you could decide as well as I could who would benefit most.
Well, they'd all benefit from the extra money and the relief from monotony.
Yes, but it would be disastrous to send anyone who would take advantage of that freedom.
Oh, you mean habitual escapees?
Yes, and troublemakers.
Most of the women make trouble because of boredom.
You didn't express any doubts when the scheme was suggested. If you have any reservations...
My only reservation would be a 5-day wonder. If this scheme falls apart, I can't see the department tackling anything similar again.
But it won't fall apart if the women are chosen with care, and if they see they will be the losers if it does collapse.
Oh, you mean that preference should be given to long-termers?
Yes, they should benefit most and are less likely to jeopardise it.
Fine, fine. Well, I do have one or two women in mind.
Good, if you could let me have the list by lunchtime.
Yes, of course, but what happens if I recommend someone with whom you disagree?
Well, if you can back your choice with good reasons, then I'm prepared to accept your judgment.
Good reasons being their potential for rehabilitation.
Well, that's what the project is aiming at, surely.
40 smackaroos a week, Davo said.
Yeah, that's more than four times what we're getting in this dump.
Is that all you can think about, the dough?
What do you mean?
The best thing about this factory, like, is getting out of this sweatshop and into the outside world, seeing a few human beings instead of screws all day long.
Oh, yeah, I'm a bit partial to the fresh air myself, but I wouldn't say no to the dough.
Me neither. You know what I'm going to do? Take Kevin for a real slap-up feed in one of those flash restaurants, and then I'll buy him, a watch. You know, one of those real good ones.
Yeah, that's what I want to get for Josie. One with a Mickey Mouse on the face. Or a real nice bangle. Yeah.
Hey, Lizzie, I wouldn't count my chickens if I were you. I mean, you've got to get on the list first.
Oh, I'm a cert.
Oh, yeah? They'll say you'll steal the boss's booze.
Oh, me? I wouldn't do a thing like that.
Well, you got a bad heart. Do you reckon you could stand the pace?
I never felt better in me life since I found me new family. I reckon I'll live to be 100.
You're way past retiring age, Lizzie. They're going to say you're too old to work in the factory.
Geez, Bea, you're a party pooper. They don't reckon she's too old to work in here.
Yeah, well, that's different. Hey, Lizzie, go easy on the cigarettes. You know Vera's counting the butts.
Got to have something to cheer you up when you get to my age. What with you and Dor going out and leaving me here on
me? Me, I won't be going out with my record. Fat chance.
Get back to work.
Tea break, Vera. Don't see where we should slug out.
Where did you get that cigarette, Birdsworth?
You talking to me?
I said, where did you get it?
Oh, Noeline, give it to me.
Oh, you and Bourke are friends now, are you?
Oh, no. No, I mean, I bought it from her. She's got plenty, you know. She got plenty in the last buy-up, enough to last her for months.
How many did she sell you?
Two or three.
And when was that?
This morning, before brekkie.
Oh.
Yeah, Bourke sold them to her.
Yeah, three or four, just before brekkie.
Yeah.
Well, it's nice to see mates sticking together. But I'm not that stupid. I'll find out where they came from.
Supposing she does ask Bourke and she tells us she didn't sell them to me.
Nah, she's in this up to her neck herself. And Vera would have to tear that storeroom apart to find out where those came from.
I'm like a broken record, but it's Gail Summers.
Any developments?
Well, she dropped in last night for a chat, and I tried to get something out of her about her husband and the way he treated the kids.
What did she say?
Nothing. She went all defensive and practically ran out of the flat. Look, she's scared, Paul.
Scared of what?
Of Tim, her husband.
Oh, well, that doesn't surprise me. He struck me as being a bit of a bully. But that doesn't mean he's bashing his kids.
But if he is and she's afraid of him, she's not likely to tell anybody in case he lays into her.
Meg, we need more proof than that before we go out charging the man.
Well, maybe we can prove it by waiting till he kills Jason.
But, well, hold on. I didn't mean that. All right, I'll go and have a talk to her, see what I can find out.
All right, well, you're the social worker. Perhaps you'll respond better to your professional touch.
Let's hope so. Hi.
Oh, g'day. You're,
Paul Reed.
Yeah, you at Meg's the other night.
That's right.
Do you want a cup of tea while you're waiting?
Oh, thanks, but,
It's real nice to have someone to talk to. Another adult, I mean. Sometimes you don't get to feel you're any person in the whole world, you know? Just me and the kids and the dirty...
Yeah, well, nappies. Actually, I didn't come here to see Meg. I came to see you.
Why?
Well, Meg's a bit concerned about you and the,
Oh, there's nothing to be concerned about. I mean, we might be a bit hard up, but Tim looks after us.
Now, how do you get on with Tim?
Listen, what are you on about? Coming in here asking personal questions.
Gail, I'm a social worker. I might be able to help you if you're worried about your husband or...
Oh, I'm not worried about me husband. No way. He's been real good to me and the kids. Looked after us real well. Well, it's not his fault if he can't get a better job in the factory.
No, I'm not concerned about money. I'm concerned about Jason.
Oh, there's nothing wrong with Jason.
Jason had an accident last week, didn't he?
Yeah, well, my husband will be home in a minute. I think you better go.
And I think it's about time you started facing up to reality. If your husband...
I said go, please.
Is my lunch ready? Who's this?
He's a social worker.
The name's Paul Reed.
Yeah, well, we don't need none of you busybodies around here. Thanks, we can manage on our own. So, on your way, eh?
And stay away.
Well, thank you very much for seeing me, Doctor, on such short notice. But the matter is rather urgent.
You said on the phone you suspected that the Summers boy was being bashed by one of his parents.
Yes, I understand that you recently treated Jason and that an X-ray showed up an old injury.
Yeah, a broken arm. I spoke to the doctor that treated him on that occasion. Mrs. Summers claims that the boy fell down the stairs while playing.
Two accidents in a very short space of time. Doesn't that strike you as rather suspicious?
There is such a thing as an accident-prone child.
And is that your opinion of how the injuries were caused? Off the record, of course.
Off the record, it's possible the boy is being bashed, aye.
Are you going to report it to the police?
What can I say? I have my suspicions, but it's pretty tricky trying to prove a case of child bashing. You, as a social worker, should know that. And I, as a doctor, must be extremely discreet. Without proof.
Yes, yes, as you say, it's pretty tricky. And I could hardly expect you to report it when I'm not prepared to do so myself.
Don't get your pacemaker in a twist, Tony, me. I've been thinking.
Oh?
About that factory work. I'm going to offer to work there myself.
Well, that's not what you said yesterday. I thought you said it was a plot to rip off the workers.
Yeah, I haven't changed my mind about that. But I'm going to beat them at their own game. I'll con them.
How?
Offer me services on the work party. Make an honest quid. Got to support the Bourke family somehow.
Listen, what'd you do with the money you won yesterday?
Oh, you stupid or what? How long do you reckon that'd keep our life? And I've got to get the money out to the kids.
Yeah, that won't be easy.
Nah, it's a cinch. I offer myself for the work party, word up the kids to hang around the factory, slip them the money and work me bum off making $40 a week. How's that for an idea?
Terrific. But first you got to get on the work party, right?
How could they refuse?
Sit down.
What's so funny?
Here's the lunch bell.
I don't like the look of Vera.
Never have myself.
Do you reckon she found out about the fags?
No. If she had, the undertakers would have been here to collect their remains by now.
Maybe Burke's got a brain after all.
Well, she's as thick as two short planks.
Vera doesn't know where to look, that's all.
Do you remember what you were saying about undertakers?
Oh, yeah.
All right, settle down. The governor would like a word with you.
I have received approval for a party of six to work at Mr. Reynolds' factory.
Come on, settle down.
Those going will be Robin Adams.
Yeah, I told you.
Doreen Byrne.
Terrific!
Judith Bryant.
Me? Terrific.
Gladys Harper. Oh, Irene Nagel.
She's never worked in her life.
And Beatrice Smith.
Beatrice.
I'm sure I don't need to tell you that any breach of discipline will mean that you will be replaced by another inmate. That is all.
Best behavior. Oh,
Smith, that's outrageous.
Paul Reed made up the list.
I bet Vera never had any say in that.
Yeah, well, I'm real glad we'll be working together.
Oh, bad luck, Lizzie.
Look, you'll get another chance.
Pig's old look. I lost my appetite.
Come on, Noeline. Listen, if that lunch is to get that money out to your family, well, why don't you give it to me? I'll smuggle it out for you.
Yeah?
I'm happy to.
I don't know. Maybe you're dinky die. I just don't trust no one that much. Not with Dosh.
If I don't get the money out of your family, who will?
I will.
How can you?
You heard what Davo said. Anybody acts up, they get taken off the work party and somebody else replaces them. I think someone just might get sprung. Oh, God, a helping agent.
What are you so happy about?
Nothing. Cancer sticks. Do you want one?
Only two. Is that all you've got left from your last buyout?
Yep.
And now you're off buyout. But you're selling Birdsworth cigarettes.
What do you mean?
She told me she was getting her supplies from you.
No, that's all you know. Birdsworth and that Anderson bitch have got more fags than you could poke a stick at.
How could they? They've been off buyout for weeks.
Didn't get them from buyout. They pinched them from the storeroom.
Good try, Burke. But I've already checked the storeroom and everything's in order. Now, if you don't tell me...
I told you, Miss Bennett, Ridgie did. But if you counted every fag in the place...
I don't have to count them. All the cartons were there.
Was there anything in them?
Now, this is another one of your little jokes.
Why don't you check it out? They probably took them from the bottom and put back the empty cartons.
Like a tip-off was spot on, Vera. Look. Found them in Birdsworth and Burns' belongings.
Well, Burns has kissed her work release goodbye. Mm. Did you search Smith's things?
Yeah, clean as a whistle.
Oh, it's a pity. I can't understand Mrs. Davidson letting a dangerous woman like that out on work release.
Yeah, well, you better get Birdsworth and Burns to the governor's office. See if she can get to the bottom of this.
With pleasure.
Wonder when you'll get your marching orders.
Eh?
To the factory. I mean, I don't mind being left here on my own while you two go jaunting off around the countryside.
Oh, don't be like that, Lizzie. We'll be working real hard and that won't be no good for your old ticker.
And you couldn't be doing that all the time either, not with a foreman watching you. Mm.
Make the most of that cigarette, Birdsworth. That's the last one you'll be having for some time.
What?
You and Burns, come with me. We're going to see the governor.
But we haven't done nothing.
No? What about your little adventure in the storeroom? Very clever. Take the packets from the bottom and the theft won't be discovered for months.
How did you find that out?
Never you mind. Come with me.
It wasn't us!
Save it for the governor.
We've been set up.
Well, I wonder if Bourke the Bourke knows anything about this. I think I'll just go and find out.
Well, well, Bourke, on your hands and knees again, are you?
Who are you crawling to this time?
What do you want?
Remember Doreen and Lizzie? Mates of mine? Well, they have just taken the rap for you, busting the storeroom cupboard.
You've got to admit that lurker taking the packets from the bottom was a real brainwave.
Yeah, it was. But Doreen and Lizzie still got sprung.
What's that got to do with me?
I want to know how Vera knew.
Knew what?
The fags were taken from the bottom cartons and they were in our cell.
Beats me. Pity about Doreen, but they reckon she'll be going to work in the factory after that.
Oh, you dirty lean bitch!
That almost never been born!
Will you stop that?
Will you stop that?
Will you stop
that? Cut that
out! Now, isn't that Charlie?
Fighting again like animals. How disgusting!
We better take Birdsworth and Burns back to the laundry. I'll take this pair to the governor's office.
Come on.
Come on, move it.
Good on you, Bing.
Look at you,
come
Bert.
Here.
Ah, oh, Meg. Glad I caught you.
Did you see Gail?
Yes. No Gail, I'm afraid. Summers came home and threw me out.
Right back where we started. Nothing to go on but my say-so.
Yeah, no, not quite. I also saw Dr. Rupert, and he believes that Jason is being bashed.
Well, did you report it?
No.
What? He's in the medical
Meg,
profession.
Meg, just hear me out. I told you this is a very tricky situation. If you report Summers, he'll be branded as a child basher, whether he's convicted or not.
It's a catch-22, isn't it? If I don't report it, who knows what's going to happen to Jason?
Well, it's up to you, Meg. Do you want to call the police?
Not yet. But I don't like it, just the same.
Neither do I. Listen, if anything else happens, you call me.
Yes, yes, I will. Well, thanks for helping anyway.
No problems. See you tomorrow.
And what's your story, Smith?
Burke's lying. She was the one that raided the cupboard.
Lagger.
You lagged on Lizzie.
All right, settle down.
Go on, Smith.
Then she got stuck in there overnight.
How did you get out?
I was never in there.
We had to go sick so we had a chance of getting near the cupboard to get her out again.
Oh, so that's the mystery illness you all had. Go on.
Then Bourke starts handing out the fags, and when she gets sprung, lags on Lizzie and Doreen.
I presume you have proof of this, Smith. After all, it is only your word against Bourke's.
Well, who else had lag? Then she thought up this little plot. She thought if Doreen got into trouble, she'd be taken off the factory project because Bourke wants to go herself.
Now, what a load of crap.
I believe you, Smith.
Then Doreen can go back to the factory?
Yes. Bourke, you'll spend 2 days in solitary confinement for stealing the cigarettes. You're getting let off lightly. You could get an addition to your sentence. As for you, Smith, however much you think you are justified in assaulting Bourke, I cannot allow you to take the law into your own hands. You will also spend 2 days in solitary confinement.
Yeah, well, I didn't expect to get away with it.
And you will be relieved of the privilege of working in the factory.
Yeah, you got you, Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Fletcher.
All right, outside. Come on, move it!
Go!
Stand it any longer. I can hear them in there now. Jason's being hit.
Yeah, well, that's gone on long enough. Call the police.
He's just so violent.
All right, just calm down, calm down. I'll be right over there.
You never learn, do you, Smith?
I got Doreen and Lizzie off the rep.
And yourself in solitary and off the project.
That must have made your day.
You should never have been on the list in the first place.
At least Doreen's going.
Oh, and you sacrificed yourself for her. How touching.
Bourke!
Oh, just a minute, Mr. Fletcher. Change your clothes. You stink. Be nice having Bourke for a neighbour.
Home, sweet home.
Well, what are you going to complain about? That's what I want to know.
All right for you. I'm stuck here all day, no one to talk to, just the kids.
Oh, yeah, that's breaking your back, isn't it? Look, it's me who does all the work. That bloody factory's no picnic.
Oh, it's no picnic here either. You can't stand Jason crying for 2 seconds. I got to listen to it all day.
Look, is a bit of peace and quiet too much to ask for? I mean, a man comes home from work to this bloody circus.
Yeah, and then you can relax. Put your feet up. Watch the telly. Go and booze with your mates. I'm stuck here all the time.
Well, if you took a bit more care of yourself, I might want to take you out. But who'd want to be seen with you in public?
Oh, how the hell can I?
I suppose that's your bloody friend Jackson as they come for a chat. Well, I'll soon sort her out. I mean, you'd rather be chatting to her than making my meals, wouldn't you?
Mr. Summers? Sergeant Bates. We'd like to ask you a few questions.
What are these two doing here?
Mrs. Jackson made the report about a couple of accidents your son Jason's had.
Yeah, well, so what? He's a clumsy little bludger, isn't he?
Did you ever hit him?
Yeah, sure, young clout.
The odd clout, eh? The doctor reported that Jason was covered in bruises. Now, you must have clouted him pretty hard and often.
Yeah, what's that supposed to mean, eh?
We have reason to believe that you're bashing your son.
Well, you're wrong. I clouted a little moron once or twice on the backside, yeah, but that's all. So you can stick your accusation. Will you shut that kid up?
I deny you hit Jason. I've seen the way you're
putting
your wife.
I think you'd better accompany me to the station, Mr. Summers.
Shut up! Just shut up!
Now, what's up with you?
Oh, God. You don't know what it's been like. Jason's screaming all day and all night. I can't stand it. I love him. And sometimes I want to kill him. I couldn't stand him crying and crying. So I threw him on the floor. It's not Tim bashing Jason. It's me.
Oh,